Good morning, students. Am I audible? Okay. Let's wait for 2 minutes. Let's order join. Okay, let's start our class. Okay, I'm sharing my screen. Let me know if it is visible or not.
So first condition is that whatever the why you are calling a thin cylinder.
Is the screen is visible?
A thin cylinder is that cylinder
screen
whose thickness is equal to diameter.
Screen is visible or not? Okay. So today we'll see we'll see the derivation of thin cylinder. Okay. Then first it will be the introduction. What is called thin cylinder and what is called thick cylinders. Okay. Then we'll see the derivation. Then we'll solve some numericals also. We'll see the derivation for spherical, hemispherical. Okay, then later on we'll move to thick cylinders also. So today we'll see first thin cylinders. Okay.
The first condition is that whatever the why you are calling a thin cylinder a thin cylinder. So first condition is that whatever the why you are calling a thin cylinder is that cylinder whose thickness d by 2 diameter, and usually this ratio is around d is internal diameter, t is the thickness. Approximately this ratio is 15 to 20. So in general that is called as the thin cylinder. Cylinders are basically used to store, one is gas and second is liquid. So this type of vessel is normally preferred to store both liquid as well as gas. These are particularly used to prefer only to store gas, which has a hemispherical end, and this one is preferred for liquids. So what are the gases and liquids are there? They will exert a pressure on this wall, and this pressure distribution is uniform if it is a gas, and the pressure distribution is non-uniform when it was liquid, because the definition of pressure for liquid is different and definition of pressure for gases is different. In the case of gas, the pressure will not change with respect to height, because governing law is PV equal to MRT. So pressure of gas is entirely dependent upon mass, temperature and volume. Has nothing to do with the height. But in the case of liquids, pressure is very sensitive to the height, because the pressure is given by rho gh. So as the height will change, the pressure will also change. So you have to first check that whether you are storing the gas or liquid. So this one, that is this thin vessel, can be fail in this plane. Is this plane is a longitudinal plane, or you can visualize this also. The cylinder will fail like this, or the chance is that the cylinder will fail in this plane. This is transverse plane. This is longitudinal plane. Both the planes are perpendicular to each other. So this will also fail in the same way. So there are only two possible failures. But if you try to fail this one, that is a spear, whether you fail like this or you fail like this, is it one and same? Why I am saying that it is the same? But if you come to this original figure, if you cut it by half, your section is different. And if you cut on this one, your section is different. If you cut here by this horizontal plane, your section is different. If you cut by this one, your section is different. So that is why we are talking about two failures. And here you cut in any plane, your section remains same. So there is only one failure. Now you have to observe the element very carefully. Element will be like this on the periphery. And because of this failure, we have one stress like this. Because of this plane, it will going to fail. So one stress will act like this. And one stress will act along this plane, but will be like this. Because I am on the curved surface. So this will try to pull in up direction. So we have a curved figure, that is how I have shown like this. Actually I have to show upward. And if we are in the third dimension, that is this dimension, third dimension. Is it third dimension? So I have to give the third dimension to this. I will get a very, very small area on the third dimension. That is, this is equals to what? Thickness. And just now we have claimed that the thickness is what? Negligible. So we don't have area. So we don't have the stress on this one. And this type of stress that is producing outside will be called as radial stress. Radial stress, and since there is no material, is the value of radial stress is zero. And if you are on this side, so this stress is called as the longitudinal stress. Why longitudinal? Because it is acting along the length. And this one is called as circumferential. Why it is called as circumferential? Because it is acting along the circumference. Is also called as hoop stress. So how many stresses we have? Three stresses. One is called as circumferential or hoop stress. Second is called as radial, that is always equals to zero. And one is longitudinal, that is sigma. Let's consider here, this is cylinder with a flat end. So let's consider here one section plan. So which section we are cutting? Longitudinal we are cutting. And if you cut this one, do you have a material at this point? And we have material here also. This length is L. From here to here, this distance is 2R. R is internal radius. And this one is thickness. So do you have this value equal to 2R? This equals to thickness T. If this area, that is the hatch area, is T multiplied by L. This area is a T multiplied by L. That is the material area called as resisting area. So this is T into L, this is 2 into L, this is 2 times T into L. And if you see this figure, that is this figure, your pressure is acting like this. So pressure is always calculated as pressure multiplied by area. So we will get the pressure on this area. It's a horizontal plane. And because of this one, we have force here. That is a pressure force. So on what area the pressure is acting? So pressure is acting on this area. It has a width equal to 2R and length equal to L. Material will become in tension. This force is applied like this. And the material will try to resist it. So because of sigma fx and sigma fy, is this stress will act in a vertically upward direction. This stress multiplied by this area must equal to pressure multiplied by this area. Then we have a balance of sigma fy. So this type of stress is called as hoop stress or called as circumferential stress. Sigma fy equal to 0. That is pressure force equal to the strength of material. So that will be equal to sigma h. 2 times P multiplied by L must equal to pressure into area is 2R multiplied by L. So from this you get the first equation of hoop stress. 2 and 2 cancel, LL cancel, is it equal to P multiplied by R divided by T. And if you write this R equal to D, it is P multiplied by D divided by twice. This act along what? Circumference. That is this value. So if you cut this one, you will get hoop stress. And if you cut this one, you will get longitudinal stress. So the hoop stress is developed because of what? Section cut through longitudinal. So every effect of hoop stress is always observed in longitudinal plane. And therefore the cracks are always developed on a horizontal surface. If the crack is developed on the horizontal surface, it is entirely due to sigma h. Okay, let's cut this in a vertical plane now, this way. If you cut like this, will you get a side view like this? So if you observe here this area, this one is an entire plate, this solid plate. This is a cylindrical tank with flat end. So we have a solid surface over here, but there is a material available here, there is a material available here. So it means that the pressure is acting only on this area. And the cylinder, this end will try to push on this side. This area corresponds to, this is the material. This is the pressure. So is the pressure is acting on this area, and is this area is pi by 4 d square. So whatever the material is present here will try to oppose this force. So I will try to show you pressure force. If the pressure force is like this, we will pushing it on that side. The stress will produce in this direction like this. And if you receive this one, it will try to pull it like this, but along the periphery. So how much peripheral area we are having? Is it a material resisting area? So just a circumference multiplied by thickness. And this time we have balance of sigma fx. Or you can say the pressure force equals to what? Strength of material. This time pressure is acting on area pi by 4 multiplied by d square. And what is the resisting area is pi dt. Corresponding strain is called as longitudinal. While longitudinal, because effect is observed on what? Length. Is it P multiplied by d divided by 4t? So you have to remember two formula, basically one formula only. One formula is PD by 2T and this formula is PD by 4T. So can we say longitudinal is always equals to sigma h divided by 2. This value is sigma h and sigma h is PD by 2T and we are going along the length. This is sigma l. So one thing is sure that this value will going to affect the length. That is, this stress is responsible for strain along the length. Whereas this value will going to change the this size, that is the circumference, and circumference means diameter. So this hoop stress is responsible for change in diameter, and longitudinal strain is responsible for change in length. So the length will increase, diameter will decrease because of Poisson ratio. And if the diameter will increase, the length has to decrease again by Poisson ratio. So if the two stress will act at a point, so this one I am showing like this. Here mara x-axis hai, and this one is y-axis, x and y-axis. So I am drawing here my state of stress. This one is my x-axis and this is y-axis. And if you are on the x-axis, you will get sigma L. And this one is sigma H. No shear stress. If there is no shear stress, is it the same as principal stress? If it is a principal stress, it's sigma max. It's sigma mean. Sigma L is PD by 4T. PD by 2t. It clearly indicates that this value is sigma h by 2. On this element, there is no shear stress. whenever element doesn't have a shear stress, it has a it itself represents principal plane. So this is itself is a principal plane because tau xy is zero, and therefore the out of two value, which one is max? This one is max. So that will be sigma max. So sigma max is same as sigma h, and sigma minimum is sigma l, and sigma l is sigma h by 2, and therefore tau max is sigma max minus sigma mean divided by 2. Put all this value, check your answer is sigma h by 4. Sigma h minus sigma h by 2, sigma h by 2 by 2, sigma h by 4. We will confirm this result from Mohr circle also. This value is sigma h. Exactly halfway we have sigma l, and therefore we have to draw Mohr circle like this. So this is Mohr circle. This is sigma max, this is sigma mean that you are familiar, and this value equals to tau max. So they will ask you what is the diameter of Mohr circle. Diameter. So the diameter of Mohr circle is same as sigma h minus sigma l. Sigma h minus sigma h by 2 is it same as sigma h by 2, and this is radius. So this is tau max. So tau max is radius. Radius is half of diameter. So it's sigma h by 4. So you get same result. For absolute shear stress, we have to assign sigma 1 is equal to sigma max is equal to sigma who. Then sigma 2 will assign as sigma l. Sigma l is same as sigma h by 2. And third stress will assign equal to 0. So the same figure I will use for absolute quantity. So is it a Mohr circle between sigma 1 and sigma 2? This one is sigma 1. This one is sigma 2. So one Mohr circle we have drawn. That is sigma 1, sigma 2. Then sigma 2 and sigma 3 we have one more Mohr circle. Sigma 3 is 0.
Yes.
So this one is sigma 2 and sigma 3 Mohr circle. And you will get one more Mohr circle. That is 1 and 3. That is this circle. If this circle has a maximum value of radius, correspondingly you will get tau max. So the tau max is this value. So this is tau max, but you have to write down absolute. If this value is, diameter is formed by sigma 1 and sigma 3. Sigma 1 minus sigma 3 divided by 2. But sigma 3 is 0. So your answer of absolute value is only sigma 1 by 2. And sigma 1 is sigma h. So absolute is sigma h by 2. Tau max absolute is sigma h by 2, and tau max is sigma h by 4. There is a difference between these two. This is valid for 2 dimensional. This is valid for 3 dimensional. If I ask you what is maximum shear stress, your answer is sigma h by 4. And if they ask you what is maximum absolute, your answer is sigma h by 2. Is the length is responsible because of sigma l? And is sigma h responsible for diameter changes? So we are back to this standard figure. Your x direction is sigma l. So your this value is sigma x basically. So in general, this value is sigma x. And this is responsible for length. This one is sigma y. We have generalized Hooke's law. That is epsilon x. Epsilon x means epsilon l. 1 by e common is equal to sigma x minus mu. Minus mu times sigma z. But we are in 2 dimensional, so last quantity is 0. So this is epsilon l. Epsilon l is change in length upon original length. Combined effect is 1 by sigma x is sigma l minus mu into sigma h. So if I take out sigma l common, I will get sigma l by e. This is 1. This value is 2 times. Sigma h is 2 times. I have to use for sigma epsilon y. Epsilon y is nothing but epsilon h. Is same as epsilon d also. Diameter change is equals to 1 by e. If y is positive, your first term is sigma y. So we'll go with epsilon d. 1 by e. What is if sigma y? Sigma h minus sigma l. Again we take out sigma l common. Is it 2 minus mu? Volume. Volume is pi by 4. Into d square into l by partial differentiation dv is equal to pi by 4 into twice d into l into dd plus pi by 4 into d square into dl. To find out volumetric strain, we'll divide it by v on this side and we'll divide it by pi by 4 d square. So this will get 2 times of dd by d plus dl by l. This is a 2 times of diametral strain. So So epsilon v equal to 2 times of diameter of strand plus strain along the length. Now epsilon v is equals to 2 times of epsilon d, that is this value. So I will write my 2 times sigma l by e into 2 minus mu plus epsilon l is this value, sigma l by e 1 minus twice mu. For whole sigma l by e common, 2 into 2 4 minus 2 times mu. Final answer is 5 u minus 4 mu is a change in volume. So you can able to find out change in length, you can able to find out change in diameter, and you can find able to find out change in volume.
So hope you have understood. The main part was the these assumptions. Okay, main part is your these assumptions, then the derivation of the main formula PD by 4T. Okay, for the longitudinal stress it is PD by 4T, and then this hoop stress it is PD by 2T, and for the longitudinal stress it is PD by 4T. Okay, hoop stress is along the circumference and your longitudinal stress is along this one. Okay, this is the hoop stress, or you can say circumferential stress, PD by twice T. So hope you understood the main concept behind how. See why hoop stress is acting. Hoop stress is acting because of the internal pressure of the fluid. Okay, it tries to break the vessel, circular vessel, into two halves. Okay, see, they have drawn the cross section also. Then go through once this video once, then you will understand. This is the longitudinal stress, so it will be easy for you to remember. See, longitudinal stress is PD by 4T and your hoop stress is PD by twice T. There's a difference of 2, 1 by 2 in both, right? So go through once this video, then you will understand more. These two derivation of these two formula is needed for now. Now they have found out the no shear stress, there will be no stress stir, and tau along TXY. Along XY direction, there will be no shear stress. But how much is the shear stress over this, this cylinder? It will be your sigma H by 4. Okay. This derivation is not needed, but you should know how much is this shear stress is acting on this cylinder. So it will be your sigma H by 4. Now they have shown with an example of Mohr circle also, so that is not required, but you should know about this. Okay, Mohr circle is very important topic, and hope you have got in your earlier engineering mechanics classes that you will get this Mohr circle in your soil also. So please clear your basics for the Mohr circles also. Okay, so they have just represented here, they have cross verified this tau max with this Mohr circle. Okay. Then they have found then at the end of the video they have shown you the derivation of change in volume. What will be the change in volume due to this hoop stress, and what will be the change in volume due to hoop stress and longitudinal stress, which is sigma l by e 5 minus 4 u. Okay. So hope you have understood. Okay, all of you can write your roll number. We'll continue in the next class about derivation for spherical, hemispherical, and numerical. Okay, then all of you write your roll numbers in the chat box.
The video should have been not provided. Let's say all of you can see there the video company or the intermediary will see this content of this video company or the service of the so big that you can
only 16 students.
So everyone will make a lot of.
Yeah, I'll call out the roll numbers. Please check. Okay. Roll number 41, 30, 22, 19, 26, 8, 12, 20, 3, 9, 17, 18, 25, 45, 29, 4, 3. Anyone left? Okay, any doubts from today's class? Any issue with the derivation part? Okay, then let's meet in the next class. Thank you.
So this is the result.